1941 William Penn Lecture, Rufus Jones, age 78. I shall assume that those to whom I am speaking today are young, at least as young as I am. The age which the calendar reveals for each one of us is not very important, nor is the size of our bald spot, nor the grayness of our hair. The really important thing is the quality of freshness and elasticity in our spirits. Welcome, friends, to the 2016 William Penn Lecture. My name is Christy Tavernelli, and I clerked the lecture working group this year, along with some wonderful friends, both PYM staff and volunteers, who gave their time and energy. The original William Penn Lecture Series began in 1916 and ran through 1966. It was begun by the young adult friends of the yearly meeting, and its goals were to draw friends together, to strengthen loyalty to the Society of Friends, and to promote the growth of the Kingdom of God. Topics were diverse, but my favorite title is 1916's The Quaker of the Future Time, which sounds a little bit like a science fiction novel. I like it because we are now those Quakers of the future time, sitting in the same meeting house a full century after George Walton delivered that lecture. He imagined the changes that would emerge in Quaker worship and business meetings, advising friends not to consider the existing forms so successful that change will be impossible. Since 2011, when the William Penn Lecture was revived, a new group of young adult friends meets each year to nominate a speaker who will similarly challenge and inspire the PYM community. It is our pleasure tonight to welcome Mary Crauderueff, a young adult friend with a deep investment in Quaker community and a passion for exploring Quaker leadership. After speaking about her project Spirit Works, Mary will facilitate a panel with a group of Quaker leaders. But first, I would like to invite Jen Karsten of Central Philadelphia Monthly Meeting to briefly introduce Mary and her work. Welcome, Mary, and welcome, Jen.
Thanks, Christy. Good evening, friends. It is my joy to introduce my friend Mary Crauderueff to you. Mary has many ties to our faith community. She's a lifelong Quaker, working for Haverford College, a Quaker institution. Try to count how many times I'm going to say the word Quaker in the next minute. She's the curator there of the Quaker Collection and a graduate of a Quaker school and a Quaker college. In her free time, she serves on Quaker search committees and on the boards of Quaker institutions. She attends conferences about Quaker archiving practices. She researches the use of children's Quaker literature as a way of teaching our testimonies, and she studies how to preserve Quaker blogs. Friends, this is a committed and dedicated young adult friend with a passion for our faith community. When she felt a leading to take on a project over a year ago, her interest was in exploring Quaker leadership vis-a-vis the intersection of the career paths and the spiritual paths of some of the heads of Quaker institutions. She received support from the Pickett Endowment, and she interviewed about 10 people to that end. I'm reminded of the words of Harvard professor Marshall Ganz, who talks about leadership with three P's, a set of practices, personality, and position. And he emphasizes that in our mainstream culture, the latter two are more often recognized and valued, position and personality. Yet when you look at that very accessible set of practices, there's something more rich and to be gained by us all. And one thing that I like about Mary's study is how she invites us to look at those sets of practices used for the faith work and the career work of some of the individuals who've been led to leadership in Quaker institutions. She's going to invite us to hear more about that study tonight. She's going to help us hear the perspectives of some other Quaker leaders from our faith on a panel she's organized. She's a member of Radnor Monthly Meeting, and there and in her social life and with all the projects that she pursues, she brings warmth, humor, curiosity, and care. I find that with her as a friend and in this community. I met her 6 years ago when she was providing service to the Pendle Hill Board. She was my boss then, and we're friends now. And so it's a pleasure to be part of an audience welcoming her message here tonight. As she prepares to speak to us from the silence, could I ask that we all please settle into a worshipful, loving state, filling this room with an atmosphere of welcome for her and her message. Friends, please hold our William Penn Lecturer, Mary Crauderueff, in your care.
Good evening, friends. So first, I would like to thank Jen for that introduction and for the support that she's been giving me through this process. And I would just like to note that she's one of the 10 people that I interviewed. She just neglected to say that. So I have a couple of thank yous to run through, because this project has been the work of a couple years and a lot of people. Let's see, I think I'm just gonna turn this down, but there we go. I'd like to first thank the William Penn Lecture Committee for the invitation, as well as PYM staff for their support. The Clarence and Lily Pickett Endowment for helping to fund my work and allowing me to travel across the country up to Maine, down to Washington, D.C., and into Philadelphia multiple times to interview folks. My friends, my family, my sweetheart, Beacon Hill Friends Meeting in Boston, where I sojourned for 8 months last year. The heads of the Quaker organizations who I interviewed, the many teachers and mentors, many of whom are here tonight, who have given me advice, supported me, encouraged me, and given me opportunities to lead. The panelists here tonight, especially, they didn't have that much notice, whose stories I'm really excited to hear along with the rest of you. And finally, you, the audience, many of whom who have been here for a really long day. So I appreciate your coming back after dinner, and I hope that you enjoy. So my lecture will be in a couple of different parts. I'll start by talking about the Spirit Works project that I did this past year, and then I'll go on to talk about the survey that I conducted over the past month, and then we'll get to hear from our awesome panelists. So in the summer of 2013, I started to get this leading. I was at the Friends General Conference summer gathering, and I had this idea. I know some heads of Quaker organizations personally, and I was like, I would love to pick their brains. I wonder what it takes for them to do their work and how it's connected to their spirituality. And then I realized there are probably other people that would really enjoy hearing those stories too. So it took me a while to actually have that leading come to anything in anything tactile. But last year, I applied for the Clarence and Lily Pickett Endowment and received funding to do this work. I was really inspired by wanting to pick their brains, but also really inspired by the idea of that career paths, they're no longer ladders. We always think of careers as this one path that we take, and you start at the bottom and you work your way to the top. But they're more like jungle gyms. And so I've had that experience in my life, and I know that others have as well. So I interviewed 10 current and recent Quaker heads of Quaker organizations about those career paths, their spiritual and religious lives, and the intersections of the two. During the past fall and early winter, I interviewed heads from many different sizes of organizations, hoping to create a range of organizations and stories. And these just got posted all online, and I'm really excited to announce that you can find them at quakerspiritworks.com. And I believe that should also be on the William Penn Lecture website. That's really exciting, and you can browse them by the person or by the question. So I hope that you all go home and enjoy those. So things that I learned from this experience. Transcription takes a lot of time. I don't know if you know this, but no interview was less than an hour long, and some were almost 2 hours. So I also want to send a shout out to the people that helped me transcribe, because it really is a lot of work, and I was really glad to have that help. But the fact is that people really wanted to share their stories. I really went into it. I had no idea how long. I knew the questions I would ask. I had no idea how long people would talk. There was lots of silence as people thought about responding, and there was lots of laughing. There was a lot of, my transcribers kept like putting in brackets, both laugh. And I'm like, I can't put that in the final thing. There was lots of laughing. People have joy about their work, and it just was, it was just so fun to get to talk with all of them on this level. I know for some of them, they talked about how rich it was to be able to talk about this part of their lives, because throughout the day-to-day work, as a lot of us do, they don't have time to sit and think about these intersections. And so hopefully I was able to provide them a little bit of time to reflect on that as well. So as I said, I got to go up to Maine, where I visited Doug Bennett, the former president at Earlham College, where he is now retired. And I got to go down to Washington, D.C. to visit Diane Randall, the head of Friends Committee on National Legislation, and where her staff gave me a tour of the building, which was really cool because they have a green building. And I also got to go to offices of heads, which visiting Jen meant that we got to sit at the barn at Pendle Hill and just laugh for 2 hours. And I also had the opportunity to Skype with a couple people as well, which I was really a little bit nervous about, because it's a really different thing sitting across the room from somebody than sitting 1,000 miles from somebody. And both Christina Repoli and Colin Saxton, who I interviewed, were wonderful, and it really felt like we were sitting across the room. So it was a really great experience. Some examples of the questions that I asked included, what faith did you grow up in? And what is important to you now about Quakerism? Have you ever left, formally or informally, for a period of time and then come back to it? What feeds your spiritual life? What struggles do you have with being faithful generally? Where do you find renewal? I'm sorry, Lynn, for breaking your rule of no water in here. When you were 15, what did you want to be when you grew up? Have you had trying times in your work, and how did you work your way through those? What influences does your faith have in your job today? How did you learn leadership skills? Was it within the Quaker world or outside of it? And describe some of the ways that you learned those. Do you feel that your work brings you closer or further away from your faith and faithfulness? Do you have a support committee, elder, or some other structure for support and accountability in your meeting? Who have your mentors been? What is something you wish you had known at an X, Y, or Z point in your spiritual path or career? What are 5 books you would recommend that have been powerful to you in your spiritual life? What is the best piece of advice you've gotten or given about your spiritual or faith journey? And this is the same for career. It was really great to see. I just quickly discovered, I was like, this is separated into spirituality and then work and then the intersections between the two. And I really quickly found that it just all was tangled up in each other. That by the time I got to the intersections, I was like, I'm not introducing this as the intersections. These are just all together, just about life. Now, I hope that, I don't know if I'm going to do the inspiring. I hope that the heads of of these organizations are going to do some inspiring. I'm going to read a couple quotes for you all. So Diane Randall from Friends Committee on National Legislation, when I asked, what is important to you now about Quakerism, responded, I think it's the notion of the lived faith, the lived gospel, the idea that there's an immediacy of God in our lives, God in my life, that I can have a sensibility about, that is informed by a community of people with whom I worship, informed by the faith tradition of the Religious Society of Friends. When I started attending meeting, I was a young mother. It was a place for us to have community of support as a family, and it was the thing that we all did together as a family every week. So that became really important because it was a consolidating element for us. I think the fact that there is a continuing practice of being a friend and a continuing revelation of what it means to be a friend, both for me personally and for the religious society, that isn't driven by council of elders, but is fomented and fermented by people around the country and world. It's a challenge to us to steep ourselves in practice and in worship. You don't have to be a Quaker head or even a weighty elder to do that. It's there for everyone. Shan Creighton from the American Friends Service Committee, when I asked her about what feeds her spiritual life, said, "This is something I learned as a child in Catholic school. The prayer is not something different from being alive. Everything you do can be a prayer. It's a matter of how you do it. I find that what I try to do is have that attitude about what I'm doing. It may be mundane, but if I can think of it as a prayer, if I can think of it as something to connect more deeply with other people, that's a good thing." Drew Smith from the Friends Council on Education, when I asked about what struggles he had with being faithful and where he finds renewal, said, "The hardest part for me is partly maintaining the discipline of worship and then trying to not feel guilty if I don't go, because as Quakers know well, or should know well, there are opportunities every day, every minute to be worshipful. I struggle with reminding myself that this is a thing that we're all sort of acculturated with. Things happen at a certain times, and it has to happen that way. I constantly struggle with the choices that I make and whether or not they reflect what I want them to or what I think they should. It's the never-ending quest to actually be the person who you believe you are and say you want to be." Barry Krosno, the General Secretary of Friends General Conference, when I asked him what he wanted to be when he was 15, this was one of the best questions, you guys. I think they all are, but I might be a little bit biased. said that when he was 15, when I was 15 years old, I wanted to do a few different things. I wanted to be a politician. I wanted to be an industrial designer or design engineer, preferably designing cars. And I wanted to work for Tibetan Buddhist Lama. When I asked Jen Karsten, executive director of Pendle Hill, what influences her faith has in her job today, she said, "In Quakerism, there's an allowance for slowness that's not mainstream. I can take a pause and choose to act with greater thoughtfulness over time than I might be able to in another workplace setting. There are some valuable things for which being able to make a quick executive decision is needed and valuable, and being able to trust in your leadership to make a decision that through the lens of time, you'll feel glad about. To be in a place where I can speak of love as that which should inspire and bind our work here. It's really magical to have to ask myself, do I pass that test? Am I coming from a place of love right now? How much of this is ego? How much of this is about crafting a sense of reputation for the staff that I need or want to have, rather than being of service and doing what's best for the greater good? Getting to play with those questions openly in the workplace is an incredible gift. It's tempting for me to want to give the right answer or to reply with clarity, when often the true answer is, I don't know. Even if you don't utter those words, just to say, I'd like some time to think about it, or can I get back to you on Monday? Something that Doug Bennett, president emeritus at Earlham College, wished that he had known at another point in his spiritual path and or career is that something that Rufus Jones, who he read a lot of, taught him deeply was that final big answers are not available to human beings, and that they are not going to fit together into any deep intellectual package. That it's okay to be comfortable with not knowing. He doesn't know how you teach somebody that, especially somebody who grows up smart, doing well in school, for whom knowing the answer comes easily, to learn that not knowing the answer is important. Gretchen Castle, from the Friends World Committee on Consultation, who I also had the pleasure of interviewing at Pendle Hill. Her office is in London, so I was very grateful that I happened to get her on a visit to the States. Wished that she knew at some point, at another point in her career or spiritual path, is that fearlessness is a really big thing for me, and part of that just comes with age and experience. As I've gotten older, I'm not worried about what people think, but rely on what I know, feel, sense, and intuit to feel confident that God is speaking through me and not worry about the outcome. I think I really like the answers that people gave to this question too, because, and I have another one for you guys. Gabe Airy from Friends Journal said that if he was to give advice to his younger self, it would have been during a period where he knew that he was a Quaker but didn't have a meeting membership and hadn't found a community to worship with. He says, my advice would have been to try harder, either to find another meeting or to talk to somebody about that, because I get so much out of being an active member of a meeting. It's easy to say, I can be a Quaker, but I don't have to go to meeting on Sunday. Every Sunday, let's have brunch or whatever. We're super fortunate here in Philadelphia because there's over 100 meetings in the area. I had to go halfway across the city to find one that really clicked for me. I should have done that earlier. And the last one, from Christina Repoli, the executive director of Quaker Voluntary Service. What is your favorite advice to give to other people who seem to be or are already on similar trajectories as you are? Don't be afraid of asking for help, asking for mentors, and doing that networking and reaching out. Especially for young people, there can be a tendency, and it was for me too, to wonder why this person would want to spend time with me or not think I'm important enough to ask this person. Generally, everyone likes to be asked for advice. Just say, I think you're interesting. Would you like to have lunch with me? Who's going to say no to that? So that's advice I give, especially to young adults. If there's something you're interested in, seek out those people that you think are going to be useful to you, good mentors and good connections. Hers was one of the first ones I did, and I guess I had some intuition about that because I got coffee for all the heads, so it must have helped get all these stories. So I want to transition to the next part of my talk. And I really invite you to read more about each of these people's stories. They're really incredible. So I received this invitation to do the lecture, and I was really honored and excited to be asked. When I was asked, they talked to me about how there's always been this lecture and maybe we could change up the format. Since I had been doing these interviews, maybe we could change that up. And so we had some ideas, and after some discernment, decided I really felt like I wanted to be more inclusive of the yearly meeting and leaders within the yearly meeting. My project, Quaker Works, Journeys of Quaker Heads of Friends Organizations, was really specific and really narrow and didn't include everybody. And so what I really wanted to do was to bring some panelists and to expand what Quaker leadership is larger than my original project, which goes back to what Jen was talking about in terms of it's not about the position, it's about leadership in other ways as well, and position especially in terms of work. So I also decided that instead of of the questions that I asked, because they were very specific to my project, I really wanted to open up to the yearly meeting to hear what you all had to say. So I asked during the continuing sessions registration, what are five words that define leadership to you? What defines Quaker leadership? who do you see as Quaker leaders in the Philadelphia Yearly Meeting area? And if you could ask one thing of someone who is in a leadership role, what would you ask? So I want to talk a little bit about the results of the survey, and then we'll have some of the questions you guys wanted to ask. So, five words that define leadership to you. Someone who is discerning, who has courage, humility, who listens, who can communicate, who is organized and persistent, someone who has compassion, someone spirit-led, and someone open. What defines Quaker leadership? Community, listening, spirit, others. And I just want to interject that I did a word cloud for this, and so others was often connected to other things, but I think it's really important to uplift that it's not just a Quaker leader, but it's all of us. Other things that define Quaker leadership. Someone who is grounded, who has leadings, who's discerning, who has patience, ability to do things, ability to discern, who has values and vision. So, questions to ask a leader. There is a whole long list of questions. So I wanted to ask some of the ones that I asked, but I also wanted to include some of the ones that you all wanted to hear. So we'll move on to that part. I first want to introduce my panel. So I'll start with Barry Scott, who currently serves as the Deputy Director of Finance for Risk Management for the City of Philadelphia, where he has also held the position of Director of Safety and Loss Prevention. He has worked as an industrial hygienist for Rahm & Haas, a chemical company, and for the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, and for Thomas Jefferson University, an academic medical center. He holds his bachelor's degree in environmental science from Rutgers University and a master's degree in occupational health from Temple University. He's certified in the comprehensive practice of industrial hygiene by the American Board of Industrial Hygiene. He has two daughters, a son, and a grandson. He is a member of Central Philadelphia Monthly Meeting of the Religious Society of Friends. He has served as clerk of Central Philadelphia Monthly Meeting, recording clerk of the Fellowship of Friends of African Descent, and on the boards of Friends Select School and Friends Center. He currently lives in the Mount Airy section of Philadelphia with his wife, Vanessa July. Thank you for joining us tonight, Barry. Becca Bubb is a lifelong member of Abington Monthly Meeting. As a young Quaker, she was active in the middle school and Young Friends programs, as well as the youth programs through the Abington Quarter Junior Friends Conference and Middle School Friends Conference. As an adult, she has served as the Young Friends Program Assistant, Clerk of the Pastoral Care in the Young Adult Friends Program, and Alternate Clerk for the Yearly Meeting. She also didn't note that she's also an alum of Earlham College. She also serves on the Abington Friends School Committee and on the Religious Education Committee at her monthly meeting. Finally, she has served as the manager of the Middle School Friends Conference in Abington Quarter for several years and remains a member of the planning committee for those two conferences, for the Abington Quarter conferences. Professionally, she works as a therapist at Arcadia University, is studying for licensure as a psychologist, and I didn't copy that last sentence, but she's been married for 7 years and has a fabulous young daughter. Our third panelist was unable to join us tonight due to her daughter feeling a bit under the weather, but I still wanted to tell you a little bit about her because she's awesome, and I just want to tell you about how I wanted to round out the panel. Jada Jackson is a member of Trenton Friends Monthly Meeting and Burlington Meeting House Worship Group. She became familiar with Friends while in high school. She has served on and clerked several monthly meeting committees and has served as its clerk. In addition, she has served 9 years as a yearly meeting clerk, clerk of interim meeting, alternate clerk, rising clerk, and clerk. She is currently a member of the American Friends Service Committee Governance Committee of the Board, Friends General Conference Personnel Committee, and a board member of Quaker Voluntary Service. Jada is a forester by training and works with the USDA Forest Service in the 20-state northern eastern area. She is the program manager for that team that administers the Forest Legacy Program. She recently did her part, and this is her words, to increase the number of friends with the recent birth of her daughter, Juniana. So I wish she could have been here tonight, but I'm glad that she's home taking care of what she needs to do. So I hope that you all can help me welcome Barry and Becca.
You have your mics on.
So I think I'm gonna go roaming so that people over here can see you too. So the first question that I'm going to ask is, what is important to you about Quakerism?
So I'll start. Well, it's home. Is that too long? I didn't grow up as a Quaker as Becca did. I grew up in the Baptist faith, and but what I've sort of identified fairly recently is that I grew up in a faith community, and so there were around me other young people and other parents and children and other older people and senior citizens, and all of us were together in a community that was organized around faith. And so what I've found in my Quaker meeting is a faith community which is very much like the one that I grew up in. And so, but it also has the elements of Quaker faith and practice that I find incredibly nurturing to my soul and spirit.
Thank you.
The question is, what's important about Quakerism?
Yeah.
Okay. I realize it was a short question, but I really resonate with a lot of what Barry said. For me, growing up, so as a child, through when I went to college, Quakerism was all about the community and the people that I got to spend time with. So coming back after college, that was all I really knew how to do or how to help was to be part of creating community and to be involved with the youth programs, and that was where my passion was. And I feel like it's changing and growing now, but I think without the grounding in community, intergenerational community, Quakerism wouldn't be what it is.
Thank you. What feeds your spiritual life?
Community? the people, the connections that I make with the people that I see when I come here. People that I don't know that I can easily approach and start conversations with. Being able to let Cora wander off and trust that she's going to make connections with all these awesome people that I haven't even made connections with yet.
So what Becca said, community is just vital, and and for me that's like the whole community. So that's the person I'm trying to avoid as well. That's that person that makes me crazy in my meeting, as if there were one. And then because I believe that that spirit has me there for a reason. And there's something that I need from that person, and God help them, there might be something that they need from me. And so that interaction, that ability to connect with another person is really what that community is about, and that really is very, very rich for me.
Thank you. Who have your mentors been?
My mother was a great blessing to me in many ways, and you know, in Quakerism, I sort of lived in Center City and live in Center City and for many years, and so when my kids were old enough to go to school, you know, we went around and looked at schools. We ended up at Friends Select, and then so one day they said, come over to the meeting house for meeting, and I got there and I realized I was home, and it really clicked for me. It felt safe. And at Central Philadelphia, I'm like, you know, there's like a whole bunch of really cool dudes. So I'm really fortunate to be connected there with people like Viv Hawkins, people like Arthur Larrabee, Pat McBee, Bruce Burchard, and others, a score of others, and who Amy Keatsman. It's just a blessing to be around some of them and really to learn much from them.
I'm going to echo my mom. I feel like there's a lot of mentors in a lot of different areas of my life. My Quaker mentors, Ruth and Charlie Peterson, who Ruth is, they're both my surrogate grandparents, as we always joke. Ruth held me when I was maybe 2 hours old, and has been more present in my life than my biological grandparents, and so I'm blessed to have them. I would say the people that I have worked with and have supported me in working in the youth programs in the early meeting. I'm not going to name names because I just feel like people will get left out. But I feel like a lot of people in this room, serving as alternate clerk, really connected me with a lot of people. And I felt so much love and support from this community, and it's really allowed me to grow as a person, as a Quaker, and as a leader. So I'm grateful to the community as well.
Excellent. Thank you. Kind of going forward from what you were saying, Becca, in terms of the leadership that you feel like you've been doing, that you did as alternate clerk, how did you recognize the gift of leadership and whatever that means to you? How did you recognize that within yourself? Or how did others recognize that for you?
So when I got the call asking me, I was shocked.
Ditto.
God, why did they ask Becca?
I understood her. I was like, why did it me?
Jen kind of answered that question actually for me earlier today, which was really enlightening. I had kind of filled in the dots for myself when I was asked. It took several days to kind of think it over, and I think I'm pretty good at listening, and I'm pretty good at expressing myself, and I'm not, I have to be intentional about shutting up and listening. So when I can balance those things right, I think it works pretty well, because I can be present and listen and synthesize and communicate back. So that kind of process as a clerk is helpful. Yeah, so I think that was kind of the piece specifically for the alternate clerk. I think my skills actually as a psychologist helps a lot, which sounds kind of funny, except that it's actually really true, because what you do in therapy most of the time is listen and repeat back what you're hearing the person tell you. shh, it's our trade secret. So I felt like it was a skill that I already had. I just needed to do it in a bigger forum.
Could you ask the question again? I'm sorry.
Oh, absolutely. How did you recognize this gift of leadership?
Easier to recognize in others than in me. So I've been... So I had to listen in order to recognize that. And so it was when others told me that maybe you'd be good at this, and that this might work, that was when I needed to listen.
Thank you. Speaking of listening, there are times to listen and times to act. How do you know when to transition to action, and what role does continued listening play?
Well, continued listening for me is vital. I feel like that's one of the things that that sometimes gets lost in, especially in leadership, is that once you started to act, you know, some people stop listening, and really, that's when it's most important. I feel sort of narrowing, focusing, hearing, expanding scope, narrowing, focusing, is a process that I go to and I go through. And it's really, it's essential for me to keep listening, though acting. Making that jump is important to get started on as well. It's sort of a process where you sort of start out small and you expand to the sort of size of the, to try to get the better picture of the size of the issue before contracting again to that place of action. And so so that's what it sort of sounds like for me.
I don't know that I have a great answer to this question. The thing that kind of keeps coming up for me is the time that I feel most led to act is when I see people not listening, And so my goal in acting is to get them to listen so that we can kind of all be in that listening space. Yeah, kind of what outside of that context, I'm not really sure.
Great, thank you. What is the best piece of advice that you've gotten about your spiritual or faith journey?
Don't do something, sit still.
I'm kind of embarrassed to say this, but nothing's really coming to me on this question.
Totally fine. So this is one of the questions from somebody who might be in this room today or submitted something. And the question is about how to become a leader in their own right, and what can they do to contribute more to PYM? How best to become a leader in their own right? If you have any ideas or suggestions.
Do what you're led to do. Speak up about what you're led to speak up about. I would say talk to people. I think that's the number one thing that ended up getting me to the places where I was, is where I would see something ahead of me that I was unsatisfied with, or that I wanted to be involved with, or wanted to see happen, or happen differently, or something. And I would kind of talk to people about it, like nudge people about it, or say something about it, or ask about it, and eventually it just happened. So, yeah.
I'd say really listen for the spirit. So it's really important for you as a leader to be connected with spirit. So sort of honing your ability to listen for the spirit and hear that and also recenter back to the spirit after you've gotten off of that, I think really helps in terms of being a leader, because you're gonna need to do that. People will intentionally, or situations, or places where you are going to push you off that center. And getting back to that center is crucial to your being a successful leader.
How do you distinguish between what seems like God's will from what seems like your own? Or do you?
So I need to say that that for me, this is something I've been in all day today. That I've repeated again and again to myself. I'm really listening to see what's your will, God, and what's my will. What is your will and what's mine? What's your will and what's mine? And and who are you, God, and who am I? Who are you, God, and who am I? And I really am in the space of appreciating the importance of me knowing that, being present to that dialogue on an ongoing basis, because, like, really, you know, the fast-paced life and action of a Quaker meeting clerk is like it'll sway you, really recognizing that that I am a physical being with many limitations and a human with many faults, and that is not what is God to me. And so that I need to be clear about what God is and who God is and who I am.
I was at a clerking workshop a couple of years ago, and one of the things that Arthur was talking about was that in a meeting, each person has a little piece of the truth, capital T truth. And you have to listen for it. I feel like I'm being really redundant tonight. You have to listen for that truth. And no one person has the truth. And so when I feel like I can make a decision without listening, that's me, that's my will. When I feel like I'm listening and when the people around me or the room is kind of buzzing with something else, that feels like God's will.
Thank you. So I feel like there's a point at which I could just keep doing this all night, but you all might not enjoy that as much as I do. So I just, can we thank our panelists? Really fantastic. Here we go. So this is what I did for an hour or two with these heads. With these 10 people, and I look forward to, hopefully over the years, continuing with more people. Just getting to sit and hear their stories and hear them kind of talk about their spiritual lives, and something that I'm really excited about is hearing just the different ways that impacts your life and the different ways that you come to leadership. And I'm just really excited to get to share a little piece of that with you all tonight. I think Christy said something about being inspirational, and I really hope that there have been some nuggets that you take away with you. I don't know if I have much else to say. Maybe we can settle into a little bit of worship. And again, I'd like to thank the panel and the organizers and you all here tonight. I just want to thank you all. And again, the website is quakerspiritworks.com. You can find a lot more of these sorts of answers up there. Thank you.
friends. Thank you for being here today. I would like to begin a brief question and answer session with Mary. So I'd like to invite Allison and Dwight up here to grab the microphones from Barry and Becca. I echo Mary's thanks so much to the panelists for being here tonight. And thank you, Mary. I think it's been a special gift to hear not only from you, but also really from an abundance of voices through the quotes you shared. And it was really cool to be sitting in the front row and hearing, as you read the quotes, things that resonated with different people. And you know, when you're in the Quaker world, I think that when someone gives you an appreciative, that you have performed like a rock star. I heard several of those. So Mary has graciously offered to answer a couple of questions about her work, this leading, the discovery she made during the process. So we'll have two mic runners and James will direct the question and answer. Please, during this time, only Mary will be answering questions. I'm sure that Becca and Barry would be happy to speak at another time, but we have taken their microphones away. And they have already been gracious to share a lot of their thoughts with us.
Thank you, Christy. Are there any questions?
Good evening.
Hi.
I was just curious to know, what would you say is the difference between a leader as laid out in your work and just a good, well-rounded Quaker?
Oh, so I'll repeat the question is, what I think the difference between the leader, the definition of a leader that I laid out in my project, and what a good Quaker is. Is that, that's a great question. And I think part of it is that we don't all need to be leaders. That some of us do, and some of us need to do some of the time need to be leaders. But that a lot of those things that I talked about that we that you all said, define Quaker leadership and define leadership, are definitely things that I think that we do or try or aspire to do as Quakers, you know, trying to be spirit-led and being open and discerning and being grounded, all of these sorts of things. I think then you also get into the definition of what's a good Quaker, which is a whole other talk. But I think that there's definitely some carryover into both of those things. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary, for your talk, and thank you to all the friends who have contributed to the work that you've been doing. The question I have is kind of a general thought about the leading process. We don't have a roadmap for following leadings. Mm-hmm. We're kind of a mess when it comes to leadings, actually. But I think of that as kind of the blessed unrest of leadings. And you said when you started about the fact that you had this inclination, this curiosity. And especially for the young friends in the room, I mean, I had the joy of attending a leading workshop kind of thing when I was in college, and it kind of broke my brain in a way for a little while because it was overwhelming. But trying to understand the clarity, everyone has their own individual process, but I'm curious if you want to embellish a bit on how you got from, well, that's a really interesting question, to actually manifesting the project that you created.
Sure, that's a great question. That process was a really long process. As I said, I first really thought about this, that this idea came to me in the summer of 2013, and we're broaching spring 2016. And it just was this spark of an idea. And then, you know, life happens, and then I found the notes again, and I was like, this would be a great project. And so I just kind of really started thinking about it again. And I think
I think I really resisted the idea that it was a leading to do this. I think I just have a lot of resistance about that. And I even, so in the application to for the endowment, you have to have a support committee from your meeting. And I was like, I don't want a support committee. There are so many people that are going to be involved with this process, and I'm going to need people to like to be resources about like what kind of microphones and recording devices to get. I don't need spiritual support, famous last words. And by the time that I applied and received the funding, I was at Beacon Hill Friends meeting up in Boston. And it was really fortuitous. Someone that I re-met up there was someone that I was had as a counselor when I was at Farm and Wilderness. This is a long way of getting to this, but and so we reconnected when I was there. And about part of the way that I was there, she moved to Pittsburgh from Boston, and I was sad to not get to see her. And then I got this money, and they were like, "So we're going to need a support person," and I got an email. So we're not really sure, like we could probably form more than one person for a committee, but this one person would be great, and we think, like if you're okay with it, it would be, would this one person be okay? And I was like, that sounds golden. It's one person, she lives in Pittsburgh, like we can do phone calls once a month. And I think that I still just really resisted the idea that I needed that support as for this leading. And it's just has been really great to have that. And in terms of discerning it being a leading, I think it's something that like you just keep getting a nudge about. I had it, and then it left, and then it came back. And whenever I would talk about it, there's just this energy. I just love this project. How could I not do this project? Do what you can't not do. And so it's just been really fun to kind of push into that, which is something that I've really resisted for a long time. So, yeah. Does that answer your question? Good. Thank you, Jen.
It seems like so much work these days is done in ad hoc teams that may be together for a week or a month and may not even be in the same place while they're working together. Did you get any insights into how Quaker leadership would work in those situations?
That's a great question. So the question is about working in ad hoc situations where you might not even be in the same room as somebody, and if I learned anything about that during this project. I don't really know. I think there wasn't anything that particularly leads me to answering that there was something that I discovered about that. I think the one thing is that in a way this was an ad hoc project, and so what I learned from it being an ad hoc project is that it's a little bit harder when people are across the country or across the ocean to be like, oh hey, you said you were gonna do this thing, or would you like to still do this thing, doing that coordination. But I think that that's just something that we deal with all the time, and I don't know if it's anything different in terms of Quaker work. I know that I've done enough Quaker work that I think that there's in other situations where there's a resistance to like, can we have worship? Can we do business over the phone? And I'm like, yes, we can. Can we please make this a conference call? And I think that there's a way to do that, to be really grounded and thoughtful and bringing the practices that we have in our physical presence to other connections as well.
Benjamin Franklin once said that that in his experience in meeting friends and talking to friends, that even though friends were modest in their beliefs and were good listeners, they in fact knew more than any other. They in fact knew more than any other group that he associated with. In other words, he was saying the friends knew a lot and had a lot of knowledge. And my question is how, I guess I'll ask, is that true? But but my real question is, how important is knowledge to spiritual life?
So the question is about how important knowledge is to spiritual life. I think that that's a really interesting question, and I think for me, I lean back on what society has kind of taught us what knowledge is. So how important are degrees? How important are all of these things? And I really want to step away from that. And I think that there's so many ways to be knowledgeable, and that that this is, in a lot of ways, like, people keep asking me today where I'm attending worship on a regular basis, and I'm not. I haven't been. I'm in the first year of a new job. I've been doing this project. I've been sleeping in, but I've been making waffles, and I was going somewhere with that. that this work, the work that I've been doing in this project, really has been doing that spiritual work for me this year. That's what I was getting to, is that sitting with people and talking with them and getting the knowledge of other people and going direct heart to heart, like, let's have this conversation. Tell me about who you are. I think that that knowledge is directly important and related to our spiritual lives.
It's interesting. This isn't a question, but just
can
as a
you,
follow,
if you can use the mic, so
just as a follow up, since because of the last thing you said, Benjamin. I was thinking of what Benjamin Franklin added after he said that. He said he thought about it a great deal, and he concluded that friends spend a lot of time in meetings and talking to each other, and that's why they're so knowledgeable. Mm-hmm.
At the beginning, you said the career paths are not a ladder, they're more of a jungle gym. Mm-hmm. And it makes me think of people like swinging on the monkey bars from one thing to another. And I wondered, from the people whom you've interviewed, were there some people who had really big swings or big shifts, like out of completely secular worlds into the kind of Quaker world, or in and out again? And if you could maybe tell us somebody who had a more of an extreme swing.
So the answer is yes, definitely. I think there are lots of big jumps, and I think it depends how you define a big jump. So Shan Creighton got her PhD in engineering, and is now the executive director of the American Friends Service Committee. That could seem like a really big leap. I think that there are other examples as well of people. I think one of the common things that I saw was that in a lot of ways throughout these stories, they're not as big of a leap as you might think, because of what other things in their lives, that even if it seems like, wow, you went from engineering to being the head of this Quaker organization, that throughout the life of the person, that it's not actually that big of a leap. And that I think that that's a story that I have done a lot of Quaker things in my life, and so, but the last thing that I did, when I was in Boston, I worked for a pharmaceutical company as an archivist, and so then I came back to a Quaker organization, and everyone's like, so Quakerism, that must be like a really different thing for you, and I'm like, oh no, this is it. And I think that that's something that you can't just look at one other thing somebody has done, you have to look at who they are as a whole person. I think I'll take one more question. Maybe from one of the young friends. Yeah, from the young friend. Yeah.
I think I'm here. How do you think that friends can use their Quaker values outside of the Quaker community to help them be a leader?
Oh, wonderful question. There are so many ways that you can use the tools that you have as a Quaker and in that as a leader outside of the Quaker world. I think something that I like to think about and that I use is about being patient and going back to what Jen was talking about when I read the piece from her. And I think it's true that in a lot of places you can't take as much time as we often do as Quakers, but I think that it's still really valuable to take a step and to say, let's just pause here for a second. There's something that we maybe need to dig into. And it's really counterculture. And I think that you might face some resistance to it, but I think that that can be really important to not just push through ideas that might not in the long run go with the values and the vision of whatever group you're working with. So thank you all, and I'll be around for a little bit. I don't know if the panelists will be, but I just want to thank you all for coming tonight. So thank you.